Yeah, welcome back, everyone. Hope you're having a nice lunch, or you had a nice lunch. So we're now back for the little panel discussing about the future of Nextcloud, and we're happy to take all your questions. So if you're in the virtual conference channel, please ask your questions, and I will try to get them here, and we'll try to answer them until roughly one when the next talk will come. So let's start with the first one by Tim. And I will just read it out. As Nextcloud gets more and more feature-rich, along comes the risk that smaller web hostings and shared hostings will not be sufficient anymore, even for small teams or families. Have you discussed anything like a private and enterprise edition, or whatever you want to name it, of Nextcloud? So I think this is a good question for Frank. You want to address that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's something that question comes up from time to time. So I know that from a textbook perspective, if you read books how to do products, then usually you hear that you really should focus on one target group. You should write software for home users or companies or individuals, big groups, small groups, and so on. It's totally different. That's of course a bit of a challenge that you really have to do like your work a few times, and maybe you can only do something that works like for companies, not home users. And with Nextcloud, we try to do something crazy, I don't know, but to actually have software that works from very, very small to very, very big, from number of users, but also from the use cases perspective. That's a bit unusual, but I think at the moment it's actually fine. The classic thinking of enterprise software is usually that it's really like completely complicated. You have all these buttons, and this has to be this enterprise software, and home user software is like usable and nice and pretty and has good design. But I don't know, maybe this is a thinking of the past. Maybe it's possible to have software that really works like also for big installations and small ones. Also from a performance, from a hosting perspective, I think this question was a little bit in this direction. We still managed to have Nextcloud so optimized and small and streamlined that it still runs on a Raspberry Pi, on a small web host, and also in a huge cluster for a few millions of users. And it's a bit crazy, I know, but it's really the same software. It really works from very small to very big. There are some things that needs configuration. So sometimes you should disable some apps that are special backend that is not really available on a Raspberry Pi or something. But overall, it's really working. And I think our strategy is to avoid this kind of community home user edition, enterprise edition, as much as possible, as long as possible, because it has so many problems. I mean, you have to do work two times. So it's really, we really want to try to keep it together, and so far it works. I mean, there are some things like the high performance backend, which is really that's a very heavy software component that you can't easily run it at home on a Raspberry. That's not possible, but that's optional, right? You don't have to use it. You can use Nextcloud Talk totally fine without it. Only if you have really 100 people in a video call, then you need it. But still then, we have this new service that we offered where you can get it hosted. So I think we want to avoid having this end user and enterprise build edition as much as possible. And so far, it's working. I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah, I think you explained it quite well. I mean, it's definitely like we want to keep it as one version, also because just the workload and the engineering load and all of it is just would just be, I mean, not necessarily doubled, but it's just also more work to do it, and it's confusing, like which version do you then use?
And
the cool thing is that because of the scalability and all the other services that you can hook into, or the optimizations, like you said, the high performance backend that just supercharges, Nextcloud itself. I think that's a really good solution.
And you can always configure it. I mean, sometimes people say, "Oh, I have so many features. I don't need all the features." Yeah, then disable it. What you don't need, that's fine. We have this plugin system, the apps. You can really disable everything you don't want, and then you have your personal set of functionality that's good for you, and that works quite fine, I think.
Okay, Tim, hope that answered it. If you have a follow-up question to that, feel free to write it. I'm going to go through some other questions first. So one from Johannes here on the dashboard. He says, I'm not sure that I really like the new dashboard features. Recommended files, what is that supposed to be? Who recommends? This looks a bit like an ad billboard, and most of its potential contents aren't really related to Nextcloud, but to external third-party services, if my perception is correct. So. It's definitely not an ad billboard because it's really catered to you. So in the case specifically, what you ask about recommended files, it's maybe the naming is not like we can change that a bit, but basically it's the files that are really relevant to you, which means basically it shows things that were recently shared with you or that were recently edited where you actually have access to. So it is actually the same thing that we have in files for some time now, where it shows on the top the recommended files, where you have these few entries of files which are not in the root folder or whichever folder you're currently in, but which are generally globally relevant. So it's at least the recommended files widget is that. And the other widgets, of course, Frank presented all these integrations and GitHub and GitLab, but all of these are personalized to you, right? So you sign in with your account, and it's not like, not any advertisement or whatever.
And optional.
It's optional. The default experience is recommended files, talk mentions, it's mails, like important emails, and upcoming events. So it's the
and even them you can disable if you don't want
even
them.
Those you can basically empty your whole dashboard or whatever, or you can only show other people's statuses or only the events. So it's definitely something that you yourself are in control of. It's like nothing would show there that is unexpected or that is not relevant to you. So one thing that is definitely something that you have to try out yourself, because if you see it with another person's data, you don't really get a sense of how it really looks like. So I really recommend to upgrade to Nextcloud 20 and check it out yourself, because then you really get a feeling for it, what will be shown.
Yeah, and if you really, really totally hate the feature, you can even disable the dashboard completely. I mean, of course, it's not recommended. Because we think it is useful, but if you really think there's not a single widget that's useful for you, then you can disable it completely. But we really think, as Jan explained, there are really dashboard widgets that are useful. I mean, for example, like upcoming calendar in events, or if someone's mentioned you in a talk, or the recommended files, it's really like it's not definitely no ads. So this is all that actually there's not a single ad on the dashboard at all. It's just recommended files are just files that you interacted with lately that we think that you probably want to keep like in touch with, basically. Yeah. And if you don't like that, disable it. That should be easier.
And for example, what I said in the keynote or in the demo is something that I really like about it, but recommended files specifically, is when we have our weekly company call, I actually get the notes, the minutes file directly, the meeting notes directly recommended there. So it's the first entry there. I can directly open it. It's super simple, very relevant. Or if you're maybe you missed the meeting because you had another meeting and you need to catch up, this file will then show up there. Yeah. Okay, so we have a bunch of people who are excited about Nextcloud 20 as an early Christmas present. So I guess that's good. Not a question, but that's cool. Thank you.
Maybe I used the Christmas too much as an example in the presentation.
Oh yeah, true. Yeah. So Simon asks, will there be an engineering revision of Nextcloud? I sometimes have the feeling that the awesome team you have together, thank you, is a bit too small to both deliver on many new features and at the same time to improve the architecture and the basis of Nextcloud significantly. There are a few high profile issues open which haven't been tackled for a while, for example. Frank, do you want to address
that? Yeah. So it's, I think Nextcloud is a software that we really plan to, I don't know, develop and keep around and improve like for many, many more years, like 10 years, 20 years, who knows. And for software, if you're coming from software engineering, then there are a lot of things you need to do to maintain a software. So there is like, of course, you want to have the features that are user facing, because we want to have good features, otherwise people use, I don't know, Google or Dropbox. We want to have the good functionality. And by the way, in our press releases and in our presentations, we focus mainly on those user-facing features because they are interesting for the non-engineers out there. But it's completely true that to keep software around, there's also stuff you need to do, like in the basement, basically, right? In the frameworks, in the stuff you don't see. There is like security stuff. I mean, you always need to update to the latest standards, the latest hashing algorithms, and the latest architectures to keep it secure. Same with scalability. It's overall, keeping up with the moving software world. And we definitely do that. We definitely do that, actually, with every single release. So with every single release, I think you can go back. With every single release, we always talked about improvements like in the backend. And here, we even have a section where we improve the way the notification system works, where we improve the way the preview system works, the authentication system, and many, many other things. So we do this all the time, because if this is not maintained, then it will, I mean, then everything falls apart after some point. So I completely agree, this needs to be done. The only thing that's maybe different with Nextcloud compared to other software is that we have this very continuous development cycle. So we have like 3 major releases a year. And with every release, we improve a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here. So over time, you have really big changes. But we don't do like big rewrites or something, because this is like dangerous and always goes wrong. So we invest a lot in this. Maybe we should talk about it more. But we invest a lot in the architecture and to keep it up to date. Otherwise, it will not work in 10 years. I don't know if this answers the question. And I don't know what high profile issues you mentioned. We are constantly, I mean, if you see the development that happens in GitHub, we are constantly working on issues, improving things with every release. Of course, maybe it's possible that people have different opinions. What's important, you know, an issue that's important for one person is not important for another. So I don't know, but if there's something where I really think this is really like critical, I mean critical like data loss or security issue or something, then like ping us here in the chat and maybe we can prioritize these issues higher. But we're constantly working on that. We're constantly improving things.
Yeah, I mean there will also be. I mean, of course, this was the keynote, right? So there's most of the like new things and the shiny stuff, of course. I mean, also of course performance and architecture, but maybe also the later talks will give you a better idea of the backend changes and all the fixes and stuff. But yeah, as Frank said, like of course these things, like the stuff that should work anyway, of course, is not usually being talked about so much anyway. So this is maybe mostly a thing of the communication rather than a problem of actually doing it. I mean, for sure there will always be issues. But also always remember that we're a big open source community. So if anyone like actually wants to look into these things or wants to fix something, they're very welcome to. And yeah, we'd love to have you in the community. So hope that answers the question, Simon. If you have follow-ups, feel free to write. So next question, also by Tim, saying, talk is on a great path, really impressive. For better privacy and burnout prevention, have you thought about a go offline button for the mobile apps like Talk and Sync, so that you can enjoy your Feierabend, like your when you're done with work, time off or vacation without colleagues contacting you? So that's a very good question, Tim, because this is exactly the idea of the do not disturb function in the new status feature. So basically, in status, you could then set, for example, Feierabend or on vacation, and then you can set the online status to do not disturb, because that's going to mute all the notifications automatically. And so as we said in the keynote, this is right now, this is already in the iOS app, and the Android app and the desktop app will also follow. So yeah, this I think is exactly basically what you're asking for.
Also, maybe I'll add a bit, also presented that we have overall final control over notifications. So we can, if some notifications really annoy you, if you don't want to know, I don't know, you don't want to know if someone changes some file or don't want to know if someone mentions you in a chat. I mean, maybe, I guess you should know that, but I don't know. You can just switch it off. You can really customize it. You can really, we really try to build a system where you don't get spammed by useless notifications. That's definitely not the idea.
Okay, next question by Biswajit. Is there any roadmap for Nextcloud in upcoming years? So that's a very good question. And as Frank already said in the first answer, we're an agile team, right? So we don't do roadmaps in terms of years, right? We do roadmaps in terms of next release, maybe rough ideas for the release after the next one. Yeah. But generally, there's like no huge roadmap planning because stuff changes, right? Competitors develop stuff, situations change, right? Like the whole COVID-19 situation completely changed everything. So you can't really, or it makes you very, very set in your ways to plan stuff ahead so far.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, you already said everything. So so there's a few things to say. I mean, first of all, there is actually a lot of planning going on GitHub. You can see, look at GitHub, where we can see issues and projects and pull requests and lots of discussions. You can have a look and you can see what's happening. Of course, most of the stuff is relatively short term. So most of the features that are discussed there are probably developed in the next few weeks or months, not years. We generally don't have a roadmap that's for a few years in the future, because as Jan said, it's, I don't know. I mean, at least I can't predict the future, so I don't, it's really hard to say, oh, in 3 years we really need this feature, this functionality. It's really hard. We try to be more agile, as Jan said, and really like be more like, yeah, do more agile, not like this huge gigantic projects which then will fail because things will change. Or in 2 years we realize that we forgot an aspect and that doesn't make sense, or I don't know. Also, remember that lots of Nextcloud is developed by the community, and with community I mean usually volunteers. Yeah, like hopefully lots of you here in the stream already, right? Yeah, you do lots of the features, and I mean, you do what you want, and this is how it should be. And because of that, there is, of course, no plan. So, I mean, we all have this shared direction where we want to go. I mean, we have our goals and values. We want to, like, privacy-minded and open source, and but productive, good usability, good accessibility, fast, and so on. So we, I think everybody in the Nextcloud community shares the same basic ideas. But what to do exactly, in what order, this is a very dynamic process. So, long answer to no, there is no secret 5-year roadmap or something. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, maybe at some point there will be a Nextcloud app for finding out the future. So, then we'll let you know. So maybe we can do some shorter answers because we have a bunch more questions. So question by Benno: when will Nextcloud Mail finally be able to move mails between folders again? I think this is actually something that is, in the new version.
I think that's in the new version. Yeah, yeah. I think that's in the new version.
Yeah. Christoph can possibly clarify. And then the next one, Cyril asks, is there a plan to improve Nextcloud's experience on iOS? Unfortunately, I have to use an iPhone at the moment, and while I see quite a few Android Nextcloud-related apps, I don't find any on iOS except the files in the Talk app. So there, as far as I know, there's also a Nextcloud News app on iOS and also Nextcloud Notes app on iOS. And there's some related ones which sync via WebDAV, I think. But yeah, it's of course true that there's more of a community on Android because, I don't know, Android is just like has more market share, and maybe the open source minded people use more Android. But in general, we're trying to, like, for example, iOS and Talk. I mean, the apps which, so to say, come from us, the company, like, we do them the same on iOS and on Android, so we make sure they're across the same across the platforms. Then, of course, community-wise, I mean, on iOS you need the developer account and stuff, so that there's a few more barriers.
But there are a lot of, actually, maybe it's true, everything, of course, what Jan said, but maybe you should look at other third-party apps that either support WebDAV, because there are actually quite some, and lots of them, I use some of them personally, they work totally fine with Nextcloud, even if they're not Nextcloud apps and not really have Nextcloud in the name. But if they can load and save from WebDAV, then it works fine with Nextcloud. And because we have this integration into the iOS Files app, basically every application that can integrate with Nextcloud, with the iOS Files app, can also then talk with Nextcloud. You can then load a file from Nextcloud through that and save it back, and then it's synced back. So I agree that there are not enough native Nextcloud apps, but there are actually quite some ways to work around it. But yeah, but hopefully more people will join our developer community. I, for example, know that our awesome iOS development team, they released an access library lately, which actually was, I think, even there's so many things, I can't mention everything in the keynote. But actually, I think the access library was completely redone now, actually, in the latest release. So we have actually a basic framework for communicating with Nextcloud. The only thing you need to do is build like the nice UI for whatever you do on top of it. But the whole authentication and exchanging data and accessing the share API and stuff is already there and you can use it. So hopefully more people will write iOS app. Yeah, I agree.
And also actually with the integration features that you also talked about in the keynote, we do have a section in the App Store which is called integration, which also lists, for example, other apps like apps on Android, apps on iOS, so other like third-party apps. So maybe you'll also find some new things that you don't know yet in there. Okay, next question from Dino. Are there any improvements to photo management planned, especially with regards to preview generation? Also asking about the Android app where photos cannot be viewed without having previews generated. So I know that there's a preview generator app that you can enable, which pre-generates the previews. So this, of course, you need to additionally enable. So this is because there's some limitations, I guess, with the default default PHP installation?
No, I mean, it's really, I don't know, that basically two ways to generate previews. One is on demand, and the other is pre-generate them. And both options have their drawbacks, right? I mean, the default is to generate them on demand, but then basically can be slow on first access, because then they're generated when you need them, and then they're slow, and then for the second time they're fast, okay, but first experience is slow. Or you use the generator app that Jan mentioned. This can generate the previews like at night or at some point you can choose. But then you don't have the previews until that time. Right? If you upload them and want to view them directly, then they're not generated because they're only generated when this app generates them. So it's a bit like we try to improve things and maybe we find a way to generate it on the fly efficiently. Maybe someone should do some research if they are. I think at the moment we still use like the old image magic. It's possible that there are other ways to which makes it faster. I mean, someone should maybe do some profiling and see if there are more efficient ways to generate previews. But yeah, overall, if you have really like gigabytes of files, you want to preview them immediately, super snappy, on a slow machine. I don't know. Open for awesome ideas how to do that. Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry, I was just looking through the questions and now I missed my... where was I? Oh, yeah. So a question from Johannes. An aspect I also didn't find addressed is, what about data security when you don't have physical control over the server, when it isn't in your own building but rented in some remote data center? Are there any ways to prevent unauthorized access apart from full disk encryption? You want to address that?
Yeah, great question. This is our end-to-end encryption feature. So overall, with security features, it is always important to think about basically the attack vector. Basically, what do you want to protect against? And most of Nextcloud, 99%, is done under the assumption that it is somehow your server, or at least you trust the server because it is the server in your organization or your family or your soccer club or something, and there's some trust in the server. But if you're in a scenario where you don't trust the server because, I don't know, maybe you don't trust the hoster or you don't trust the admin, or you're under assumption that maybe the server is hacked, then you can't trust the server, but you still want to work with the server. And that's a bit of a tricky attack vector. But for that, we have the end-to-end encryption feature where all the data are encrypted on the clients, the iOS, Android, Mac, Windows, and Linux client. And there's on the server, there's always only the encrypted data and only the encrypted keys. So there's no way you can change everything you want on the server. You can be the biggest hacker ever. You don't have all the information to get your data back. But of course, unfortunately, the end-to-end encryption feature comes with some drawbacks. There is no perfect solution for everything. For example, the web interface doesn't work anymore because the web interface can't like decrypt the data. Of course, then you say, well, web interface is JavaScript running on my side. Yeah, sure, but the code comes from the server, so the code could be manipulated to do that. So the web interface doesn't work. Sharing also doesn't really work at the moment, could be improved a little bit in the future, but there are some limitations. Stuff like search, for example, can't work, right? Because in encrypted data, you can't search. The previews from the previous question, there are no previews for encrypted files because they're generated on the server. Maybe your client can generate them, that's okay. But so it comes with limitations. So basically, using Nextcloud in a scenario where your server is hostile, basically, to you, that's tricky. That's end-to-end encryption can help a bit, but yeah, that's tricky.
Okay, we have a very important question from Christoph, actually. He asks, does pineapple belong on pizza? And I think I can answer that with an anecdote.
Are you sure it's the same answer that I give? No.
I'm not sure. You can weigh in. So a friend of mine from Italy, he says,
oh, that's awesome.
He says that well, it is considered quite unholy, but you can also not deny that it's really tasty.
So, oh, a controversial yes. Answer.
Don't know if you want to add to that.
Oh, whatever you say, you will be hated by some people, right?
Yeah. So I hope this, it wasn't me who said that, so I can defer.
I personally, I don't know, I personally don't mind the ananas.
Fruity.
But I have a big problem with other stuff. Like I don't know.
Spaghetti bolognese on the pizza.
Cheese in the crust or like whatever pizza which is that high or stuff like that.
Let's maybe step back from the holy wars and
but ananas
So next question, actually back to Nextcloud. from Stefan, question about the hope this helped clear up that question, Christoph. So question from Stefan about the future of Nextcloud GmbH. Or Nextcloud, the company. How many people are working for you, as in paid, and how many are just contributing, unpaid, so volunteers? Are you growing much through the support subscriptions? And it would be interesting to hear some numbers. And thanks for the awesome work. Thank you, Stefan. Yeah, do you want to?
Cool. Yeah, sure. The Nextcloud company, this was quite an adventure. We founded this 4.5 years ago. I mean, Jan and 10 other people and me, because we decided to found a new company, a new product, everything new, and then also decided very at the beginning that everything we do should be open source, so we couldn't use like the normal software licensing business. So we already decided that we want to, I don't know, do it in a specific, special way. And then the question is, of course, will it work? Will companies pay for what we do? And will they pay enough that we can then pay our salaries and then hire more people? But now, after 4.5 years, I'm really happy. You can believe me, I'm really happy to say that this works. So we are growing a lot, actually a lot. I don't want to say too much about the numbers of this year, but a lot. And we can also hire more people, we can do more events and more stuff. So overall, this is actually working. We have around 50 people, I think, fully paid in the company. And hopefully a lot more in the future, and it looks like it at the moment. But this is like additionally to the community. In the community, with community, I mainly mean unpaid volunteer community, because we also consider ourselves part of the community, but I mean the volunteers. The volunteers are hard to count. Impossible, actually. If you look at the code contributions alone in GitHub, then you can see that there are over 2,000 people who contributed code over the time. That's already a lot, but it's only code. There's a lot more contributions. I mean, like there are over 90 translations, 90 languages available. They're not even counted. I don't even know how many people translating Nextcloud, a lot. Yeah, and people doing events and installations and like walking around recommending Nextcloud to your friends and family. I also consider them part of Nextcloud. They're all like part of the whole friends ecosystem. And I don't have the numbers, but thousands.
Yeah. Yeah, and thank you all for being part of it. So
Yeah, I mean, everybody who is watching this video is definitely already part of it.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah, and all of us for sure also started in the community. Like even the people who work at Nextcloud GmbH at the company, yeah. They all started in the community. So this is that's why what makes it so cool. Awesome. I don't know how much time we have because I think Jos's talk is at 3. Should we do a few more questions or do you wanna? Okay.
Maybe one.
Yeah, maybe one more. We have a question about training from Tim. Training for end users gets more and more of a thing. People are just overwhelmed by all the features, which are cool, but a challenge. We provide trainings and Q&A sessions for our staff, colleagues, and partner organizations, but I guess it would be cooler to work together on that somehow. So maybe you want to?
Yeah, super cool. We didn't have time so far. To do like lots of end user training, there's limited time, and we have to do the software and do other things. So we didn't do a lot of training as Nextcloud so far. But if someone like you can help and we can work together, that's awesome. Of course, there is a little bit of the hope that our software is so usable that you can figure it out on your own. But I know that there are some limits.
Yeah. If you have any feedback, let me know.
Yeah, it's pretty clear there are some areas where training is useful.
Yeah.
And I have someone where we can do this together, which would be super nice.
Yeah. So should we conclude with that? There's a bunch more questions, of course. I mean, we didn't manage every one of them. So sorry about that. I hope other people in the chat can answer it. Feel free to ask it again so people in the chat see it and we can answer it. But we have to switch to the talk so we don't get so we get back on track on the time. So thanks everyone for the cool questions.
Yeah.
Hope you learned something or you got more insight. Thanks, Frank. Let's continue with the talks now, with the rest of the schedule.
Perfect.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.